All right, everybody, let's do the administrative stuff, get this baby rolling here. Dave Duncan here from ICA. Thanks for joining our ICA Model Services Catalog webcast. It's our first webcast in a little while. I wanted to introduce to those of you who haven't met her, Brittany is here as our education event coordinator. Say hi, Brittany.
Hello, everyone.
We're working with a lot of our planning teams on a lot of the events that are coming up, and many of you probably met her at the golf outing if you were there. So for purposes of this webcast, I'm doing some of the intros, and then all our future webcasts, Brittany's going to be in charge of all the intros and everything. But as we get started, I'd like to remind everybody to mute your own phone if you can, so that we don't have to hear background noise. If there is what we see is too much background noise, we will put this into presentation mode, and that will cause everybody except the moderators to be muted. There are ways to ask questions throughout the webcast. There's two ways. On the screen that you're looking at on the left-hand side, you should see something called chat, and you should be able to just type a chat request in there if you'd like. Number two, on the top of the toolbar near the right-hand side, you'll see an icon that looks kind of like a hand with a finger, like an index finger pointing up. You click on that, and then it kind of gives us a notation that somebody wants to ask a question. And so as we got prepared for this, did all the presenters, do you want them to ask questions during the presentation, or do you want them to wait to the end? Did we decide that?
I don't know if we decided that, but I think maybe we could suggest that people hold to the end, but if there's a question that comes up and needs to be addressed right then and there, we would do that.
Okay, so hold it to the end in case you don't want to hold it to the end, unless you don't want to hold it to the end, then bring up the question now. That's what John said.
I do think it'll maybe be beneficial for everyone to hear sort of the full presentation before tonight and your questions. So probably best if you hold those questions to the end, but make sure, make note then, I guess, be prepared to make note of your questions so you can remember to ask it as we get to that end point.
Okay. So do it that way. But you could still write down your chat questions, and we will go through all of those, and we'll make sure everybody's questions get answered. As we get started, I want to make sure that we thank our all event sponsors. I'll sponsor all of our webcasts and our in-person events. BKD, and we've got a couple folks here from BKD, Bernie and Lori, thank you. Finley Engineering, Huntel Engineering, ITCI, Oak Hill Consulting. Thanks to the all event sponsors. We've got some upcoming events. We want to kind of plug into your calendars. September 11th and 12th is our Convergence TV event, and that's going to be in West Des Moines. That was formerly known as our Envision conference, which also was known as the video conference. So Convergence TV is kind of the ultimate phase of where we're going as broadband and digital television come together. It's a full-day conference on the 12th with pre-session workshops on the 11th. And then the evening of the 11th, you'll want to be there for that because Caitlin's going to put together the second annual beer and bus cruise out in West Des Moines as a PAC fundraiser. We're going to hop on a rickety old school bus and go to a few different watering holes in West Des Moines, and last year that was a lot of fun. So more information will come out about that. The next event after that is what we formerly called our leadership conference that was in June. This is generated and geared towards general managers, CEOs, and any managerial level person inside of any of our companies, whether associate members or telcos. And we've renamed that conference to be something new, and I forget what the name was because we just decided it today. But it's no longer called the Leadership Conference, but it's all about leadership. And that's going to be October 2nd at the casino in Jefferson. So you will want to go to that. And then we have the Impact Conference that we've had for many years in November on the 14th and the 15th. And that one is geared mostly towards customer service folks and technical folks and GMs. So you'll hear a lot more about each of those, but I'm going to lay those on the table, let you know that we've got all kinds of fun things going on. So as we get moving here, let's go to the next slide. And I want to say thanks to the work group who has really done a nice job of working on this model services catalog. You can see that we have Bill Vanderslice from Olson Thielen, Bernie Snoddy, BKD, John Patella, Dave Brown Law Firm, Roger Craigle DeMana. I listed those on the left-hand side because they're all going to be in the talk today. Other members on the right-hand side, Scott Butler, Kevin Miska, Bob Larson, Jerry Flick, this team has done a fantastic job, and I also wanted to give a special shout-out to Lori Hagan at BKD. She's sitting here today. She helped format this document once we got to the point of throwing all these different ideas from different places into one document, and it looked kind of messy. And thank you, Lori, for making it look professional. So with that, we'll go to the next slide. As we talk about what is the mission of this group, was formed last fall to take a look at what was the old local services tariff. And then once the IEB deregulated local services, then the advice that we as the back then it was the ITA, as we're getting ready to unify with ICA, the advice coming out was, okay, just take the local services tariff and turn it into a services catalog, put it on your website, delete the tariff and services catalog, and just keep it as is. But in the meantime, there was all kinds of changes going on at the utilities board on deregulation and being rid of a lot of the old and outdated regulations of telephone service, the engineering standards, a lot of those things that had driven the old local services tariff. And then in addition to that, as hopefully all of you know, this year was a very successful year at our legislature, and the Iowa legislature approved a sweeping deregulation bill locally. A lot of other requirements that basically were kind of micromanaging how everybody was running their local exchange operations. And again, the most of this deregulation is on the retail side, not the wholesale side. So back to the old local services tariff. This is all dealing with the relationship between the company and the customer. So this task force that I introduced, Bill Vanderslice and Bernie Snoddy were co-chairs. Their mission was to simplify and eliminate outdated items. And then as they started talking, they thought that we should have some terms and conditions to kind of modernize things and add in some terms and conditions that people might want to consider using for cable TV and for broadband. So what we're talking about is taking some rules of the road and balance reasonable protections for our companies, our members, with the rights of the customers as well. So yes, this document is intended to be a replacement for the outdated ICA services catalog, which many or maybe most of you are using today. And there's an opportunity for you to take a look at this and use it as you see fit. We sent out a special report last week that included a hard copy of the terms and conditions, and it's also on our website under the member resources page. So it's always available online. as well, but it's going to provide a framework for you all to take a look at. Before I get started, some of the members on our task force wanted this to be a much shorter document, and some of the members on the task force wanted it to be a longer document with more protections and terms and conditions. So this was kind of the happy medium where everybody came out. So again, it's a model. You can decide what you want to do with it. With that, part of the next slide. And I think I'll turn it over to Bill. Bernie, how about if I turn it to Bernie first?
Okay, well, this just shows an overview. This part of it is the overview or table of contents included in this section. The part one is we tried to take all the general rules and the regulations and the subjects within the whole confines of the document to put it in the part one, and so we didn't have competitive rules throughout the thing for different services. So everywhere we could, we pulled in the common rules or guidelines into the part one instead of into the individual segment. So part one is the general rules and regulations. Part two covers the telephone service. Most of those services are the same as they were previously. And part three is addition. We have the broadband service for those permitted. And then number four is cable telephone service provided and or want their price structure and services listed in it. And then part five is the service price sheets, which is essentially the non-recurring charges and the monthly charges. And in that, we'll go through that in more detail. But, it is a segment where your pricing structure will be. Okay, and then the next one. Okay, I think Dave alluded to this, but I'm going to make it a little more clear. This is a volunteer template. There's nothing that requires I think it's good business to have a list of your services available to your customers so you can have it, but there's nothing that requires you to use this. You can use some of it, all of it, or none of it. So, if you only want to use the telephony piece of it, it's certainly an option that's available to you. So if you choose to just use the parts that you want, that's okay. You can do that. And if you can add other parts, if you have services that are not included here, so if you want to sell shoes, you can put that in part six. Okay, then I guess I have done that part of the presentation.
Okay, thank you, Bernie. I'm going to cover some of the tactical things that member companies will need to do in order to best use this model template. And so there are several pieces in the template where we've since left a blank or left a space for you to fill in or place some information that will customize the model catalog to your specific application. So the first entry that's going to be needed is on the title page. You'll need to list your company name and the date that you start using this document. Additionally, in conjunction with that, there are headers and footers in the document that have the company name and the effective date. And many of the headers are linked, but when I looked at the document this morning, it appears that you have to put your name in more than once. And so you'll have to look at how the headers are linked to make sure that your company name shows up on every page. And then you need to do the same thing with placing an effective date in the footer. In addition to that, on page one, part one, there is a place to list the company name and to list or use fill in the box how many of the services that are listed in this catalog that you intend for it to cover. So the idea is just to check those off. And, you know, this is probably a good time if you're looking at part one, page one, to note that we talked a lot in the past about what we felt were best practices, wanted this document to reflect best practices in the industry. And that we decided to continue is the concept of where you'd put margin flags in future revisions. And so in essence, as you're using the document, we had contemplated that each time you iterate, you would put, you know, change flags or deletion flags or whatever in the margin. Then you'd also up the revision date for your page, moving from moving to revision one and then revision two and so on, and at the same time you change the effective date. This should give you, as a result, the document that you keep on file in very easy to see when changes were made and what the last changes were for any given page. And then on slide seven, in addition to the part one, page one selection, there's two other things that I want to point out that are special note where a member must designate an election using this model. The first one of those is a dispute resolution process option, which needs to be designated on part two, page 21. And here, a member needs to select whether to use the civil court system or an arbitration process for the resolution of disputes. This obviously stems from the fact that these services are deregulated and this type of dispute can no longer be heard by the Iowa Utility Board. For members that have contracts or anything, really, you may have already decided one or the other. This is just a place to have terms and conditions model match up with what your business practice is going to be. The other place where there's designation necessary is on part two, page 12, and this is to allow an election where companies can designate whether they still publish a directory and are doing business on that basis or whether they're simply providing listing information to an independent third party directory publisher. And again, they might as well accommodate these of these, but it is very desirable to make this election and let your terms and conditions, let your customers know which of business practices you're using. And with that, we'll move on to John.
Well, thank you, Bill and Brooke and Dave. So, again, I want to just talk a little bit about some of the legal implications or legal questions that the task force wrestled with as we were trying to determine what might work best for quote unquote a model for ICA members. And so I think that first bullet point was an important factor, which is this is intended to incorporate current practices. What were our companies used to and how were they operating at the time that retail services were subject to that tariff? But then also input from the members on the committee and from outside of the task force in terms of practices that maybe have changed or that we would like to change, or that were priorities for folks to change. And so, again, we're going to leave individual companies to select what works best for them. This model is the product of input, but may not be perfect or may not be right for your specific circumstances. It's critical for me to underscore
we want you to post a service catalog that is consistent with your business practices. So to review this catalog and see things in there that you don't do or that you've decided you want to discontinue doing, you'll want to work either internally or with your advisors to get your catalog to reflect your actual business practices. So this is intended to be an operational document for you and for your customers, and it should reflect the reality of that relationship. This model document is consistent with IEB and FCC rules. As services become more and more regulated, or as always to be regulated, there's more flexibility than we're used to have. And as the IUB clarifies some of what it did with the Chapter 2 regulation, we may learn things that may cause us to make revisions or to suggest updates. It's going to be up to independent companies to make decisions about the degree to which they may want to remove things from the service catalog because a rule that was in place has been moved or differently. Bill touched on this and Bernie touched on this. The IUB does not have oversight or authority over this document. So to the extent the IUB retains any complaint authority at this point in time, we believe that authority will be limited to the availability of service in a particular area and not the terms of service or the quality of service or rates of service that a company is offering. So this document is going to be posted on your website. It's not filed with the Iowa Utilities Board. It's not going to be approved by the Iowa Utilities Board. And that's not to say the Iowa Utilities Board will ever ask you to see a copy of your service. They will have jurisdiction for what specifically is or is not included, and will have very little jurisdiction over your relationship with the customer for these services. The dispute resolution options, Bill has already talked about those. As a task force, we were prepared to help people that arbitration is better than courts or vice versa. Those are questions or issues we thought best to leave the individual companies to make those decisions. If you want to make an alternative dispute resolution decision, you have to use the language. There's an area in a certain catalog to capture whatever fits or suits your company needs, and we encourage you to think carefully about that. And then sort of the last important point, this can be a standalone document, and so it could be something that a company uses as its sole customer-facing terms and conditions service. We thought about it as a team, in part because of the work we've done with many of you and the situation for many of you, especially with your broadband and video services. If you have existing contracts, if you have existing terms and conditions, this document can be used as simply another tool in your toolbox in terms of customer thinking. So that's always been perhaps there for voice service. As somebody said early on, maybe you just keep it for voice service. Or maybe you roll those broadband and video terms and conditions in with that. We don't have to go into a lot of detail about how that works. There is a section in part one on page two that talks about service publication. And so if you do have your service publication, you want to read that language and make sure that you agree with what the model says about how those different terms and conditions may relate to this document. If you don't have those other service publications, you decide that you want to remove that part from your service catalog in order to not confuse the customer. So there is going to be a lot of customization, we hope, within our model form, and we're going to give everybody a solid platform to start that customization from. I'll say one thing, and this is where you can get your pen and paper out and write this down, but John Patilla said this on the webcam. Are these kinds of terms of service enforceable? You post on me. I think that is yes, they can be enforceable. And what's going to be important? Number one is reasonable notice to your customer. you need to find a way, or probably multiple ways, of providing your customers with reasonable notice that these terms and conditions apply to that they receive from you and that are covered by the service catalog. The second one is trickier, and that's acceptance. And so courts will ask, when did a customer accept your terms of service? You'll remember when we first had de-tariffed at the retail level, prepared a model, a short two-page agreement, and that agreement incorporated the service catalog. And so customers who signed that have incorporated that service catalog. There are other methods that you can use. But one method is to have a service application or a service agreement that would have to stick notice in signing the application by signing this agreement. I recognize that I'm governed by your terms of service that will be posted on the internet. And so we want to be able to give reasonable notice. We want to find convenient ways to get that acceptance. It's a different scenario for new customers and existing customers. We went through all that with de-tariffing. And then finally, are the terms fair? And so, again, one of the reasons that we've tried to carry over as much as we could from the previous tariff and the previous service catalog was simply those terms seemed to us to be defensible as fair. They were in a tariff approved by a regulatory authority. We took them out of that tariff and put them in the service catalog. We've carried that service catalog over now into a revised service catalog. That doesn't mean that we get to decide what's fair or not fair. That's going to be a case-by-case scenario. But to the extent you customize this and you've got some terms and conditions out there, what you want to think of yourself is you get a fair term for the customer. And so we had a lot of discussion about a lot of areas as a team. We can't make those decisions, obviously, and we can't be the final authority for that. But those are the three factors: reasonable notice, acceptance from the customer, and still onerous or one-sided that a court's going to throw them out for being unfair. And with that, I think we can do ahead to the next slide.
I think this one goes over to Bernie. Nope, Bill.
Sooner or later, we'll get this one right.
You want it, Bill?
No, I have, this is Bernie, slide 11. But
I think we're on slide 9. General terms and conditions?
Okay. Yeah. Okay, thank you. And thanks, John. As John and Bernie mentioned earlier, the model catalog includes four parts for describing four parts, including service terms and conditions, then a part just price slip. And this has already been explained pretty well. Part one is general terms of all of those services. Includes many of the legacy provisions from the earlier tariff or catalog language. And then, as part of our discussions, we also decided to broaden those terms so that they could cover other services and set up two separate parts for cable TV and broadband, as well as for telephone, thinking that that would best cover a majority of the ICA members offer today. Then, as we move on to the next slide, as John said, I'll of course work through a whole variety of issues that were associated with evolving regulation. It became apparent there were a couple of areas that we had to make substantive additions to the way the old catalog was constructed, and that led to these new documents. John has described in some detail the clarifying information on the applicability and the priorities of the various public funds. And so that's the piece that was added. And then additionally, we felt it was appropriate to add a privacy section. And this was added at the end of part one to cover privacy. That is, it covers data privacy, personally identifiable information, or PII, and PII. The text in these six pages should cover then privacy compliance for all three types of service that are covered in this model catalog, as there are a variety of different, particularly FCC rules about publication of what privacy policies are. And this is intended to be a minimal policy that companies need to be compliant with the rules as we understood them. And so with that, we move to 11.
This slide covers the, you know, telephone terms and conditions, most of which are been from the existing for the services that were in the service catalog. Obviously, there are things that may or may not be in, you know, for every company, you may have to add additional services if you have them under the telephony terms and conditions. And so most of it, like I said, was moved. Some of the information that was in the terms and conditions, telephone terms and conditions, was moved to the general terms. So you'll find that if you're looking for something specific, you may find it in general terms opposed to here. And to clarify here, in the next segment here, the new items, the construction charges are actually still in part one, but the construction charges are added to include, to make it easier, I guess, for you to recover construction charges and to have it outlined in your catalog. So it always before, the only option you had was the line extensions, and they're kind of cumbersome. They didn't necessarily allow you to recover your construction charges, but this segment of the document will, and it's on page 117 of the existing document. The deposit and policy interest is another item that was left in here, although it did change because the rules changed. So as you start to utilize or look at this document, you should look at the deposit policy, the amount of interest rate charge, and those kinds of things. So, and that too is still in the part one, and it's in part one, page 1-13 through 15. And then the advanced services were added into the various parts of the thing, where you can include both ISDN that were never or hadn't been in the tariff for some time, or ISDN had not. I don't know if it ever had been. But anyway, these are addressed in the document as well. And then we did some modification to not only the 911, as the old tariff includes a lot of language in the 911 section that companies didn't offer, really. I mean, the 911 in the tariff was to do with the services that only in the state of Iowa that only CenturyLink provides. But we changed that, modified the language in there to include the 911 to make it more definitive for most of the other N11 services. But to still give it a definitive probably a little clearer understanding of what it is and what it isn't that comes actually provide this 911 service. So, okay, then on to the next slide.
Okay, I see the question, Steph, that I'll back and maybe touch on that as we get through the catalog, and we'll stick sort of to the script here on the broadband services terms and conditions. So, broadband and video are, I think, the most interesting questions because, of course, telephone service was always subject to that tariff. The rules that they talked about, I stated those telephone terms apply to always only to telephone service. And so a lot of you have been doing your own thing with cable and with broadband service. The broadband module then is intended to build on the general terms and conditions that we've put up front. Those don't apply just to telephone service. Those apply to all three of the services that you may be offering. As you know, this is part of network convergence. And so when we talk about delivering and data over a single network, we've always thought, well, what general terms and conditions need to be different? And so the broadband services has some very basic general terms and conditions, including the opportunity to identify types of broadband services that you're offering to customers on a retail basis. It's an opportunity to, as required by the FCC rules, to make those commercial terms of your broadband service available in one place where customers can identify that on your website and then keep that updated to comply with your transparency requirements up at the federal level. We've got a copyright protection notice so that copyright owners understand that we do qualify for the safe harbor, and notice of copyright infringement will follow the applicable law, including the notice and takedown process. So again, if you've got your own broadband policies and procedures out there, the service catalog assumes that you'll insert language consistent with those policies or links to those policies, including, and we can head to the next slide, including that network management policy and acceptable use policy. As Bill discussed, we think, I guess I'll speak for the whole team here, or maybe I'll speak for general counsel for the Alliance, people ought to have an acceptable use policy. They need to have a network management policy, and they need to have a privacy policy as an internet service provider. Companies who have been looking for guidance and updates on those, we expect to have something at Davis Brown. I'm sure other consultants you can refer to as well. You policies that are in compliance right now, again, this provides an excellent platform for you to use to communicate those to your broadband customers. The copyright protection notice we've talked about, so I think we can move on to Roger and get television.
Hey, can you guys hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. Just follow up a few reminders on part four of the cable TV. You know, as was discussed earlier, the committee comes at this from different angles, from the company perspective and the customer perspective, and I would say part four of the cable TV is written in a way that informs the customer more. Again, just like the rest of this whole document, you can use any of it, all of it, or none of it. But remember, you do need to personalize this to your individual company. Information for this cable TV section, part came from the FCC website, the IUB website, and some existing individual company policies. We've got a group of information gathered from. The one thing that I will, if you read through part four in detail, you may have noticed that, you know, in this section, we did not specifically mention KTV sharing or the equipment boxes. And but that is considered to be included in section C2 of the general terms and conditions that was discussed earlier, and it's labeled connection and customer equipment wiring. So That's one of the examples that Bernie mentioned, that we tried to merge everything together and the wiring and that type of stuff is earlier under customer premise equipment wiring. Next slide, we can go to, there's not a second, it's real brief, and I'll just make a comment on each. The general, letter A, general, this just tells the customer, you know what, these services are video services, and it's for residential and business. And they're regulated by an FCC or the franchising authority. And then letter B is the franchising authority, and that's either the local or state, and how your company has done it pursuant to the Iowa code. So and a lot of that relates to public rights of way. So underneath letter B also mentions, you know what, the franchising authority, whoever they are, have the ability to charge franchise fees. So that's just conforming the customer to that. Letter C is the provider authority, the service provider authority, which is all above. And that's just telling the customer, you know what, the service provider decides which programming services they want to carry on their system. They also decide what the rates are. And the rates are set by the service provider, and that is not a regulated service. So that's telling the customers that. Letter D is types of services. Some of these terms may work for your companies. You may have to redefine it, but the ones that we have down are, you know, basic service, enhanced basic, premium channels, pay-per-view, video on demand, standard high definition services. And then there's another line item there that informs the customer, you know, content on these channels is decided by the content provider. There's a lot of people out there that think we as service providers decide what's on these channels, and we really don't. But that's a line item they're telling customers the content provider makes those decisions. Letter E is a section where for cable TV channel lineup. Now here's a good example of where there's great difference between all the companies. You know, some companies may want a full channel lineup in this document, some companies don't. The companies that do want this in there are companies that have this document readily available and their CSRs use it daily working with customers. And some companies that CSRs aren't using this document closely, or they just don't want multiple locations to have to update this lineup because that is time consuming. So you're going to have to decide whether you want section E, the lineup in your document. Section F is under the next slide. Section F is the price list and rate card. I think that's going to be talked about later. And G talks informs the customer, you know what, this is the charges that our company puts on the customer's bills, and it can be anything from a franchise fee that's applied from that the companies pass along from the franchising authority, retransmission. Some companies separate identify the retransmission rate separately. Programming fees or your regular programming fees for the remaining satellite channels. Other types of charges are equipment rental, which, you know, all not inclusive, but set-top boxes, DVRs, etc. And then, of course, there's taxes on the bill. So that informs the customer what types of charges that you're going to put on the bill for cable TV service. And then the last two are a lot of information for the customer. H is more about if customers have complaints, it gives them section where there's contact a service provider first. If we're not doing it, satisfying them, they do have the ability to contact a local franchising authority. They are able to contact the FCC for certain things relating to children's programming, indecency, or some premise wiring or that type of complaints. And then it also has a comment under that section H about systems or companies that have 1,000 or more subscribers, because there's different rules relating to that. And companies more than 1,000 video subscribers have a public inspection files. That's section H. And then we felt that section I is just informing the customer again, if they have some other options, that they do have other options. Again, you may not want to provide this to the customer, but you know, there's information there about explaining what has happened when things went digital, things did or further. And services are also available online and kind of pushing towards the broadband side. So that is what is included in the part for cable TV, and I'll turn it back to you guys.
Excellent. I think we're going to Bill for the service part five.
Thanks, Dave and Roger. Roger mentioned the service price list, others have as well. As we said before, it's a separate section for pricing. This was intended to make it easy to manage your future pricing changes without having to change pages throughout the document. It contains at least a list of accounts that we thought were going to apply to most members, at this point. And it allows you really to your cases in a manner that's similar to a list that you would be able to perhaps pull out of your billing system goals. And so we provided a column that would allow you to cross-reference to that bill code if you have bill codes as well. As others have mentioned, we'd encourage members to use this table as much as possible, and also to put as many of the billing elements or as many of the prices that you have in your system in here as possible. Some of the extra fees that Roger just mentioned are an excellent example of that. There may be others as well. I think when we talked about interest a little bit ago, the piece on interest paid on deposits was left up to the providing member, as long as it's reasonable. So you would probably want to declare in your findings the level of interest you're going to pay on deposits as well as the amount of the deposits and how you're going to do those kind of things. The idea was to capture all that in this separate section so that information was available in a compact location. Another area that companies may have pricing deregulated services that are not covered in this catalog at the present time, at least in the language, is any in-state special access services that you may have, as those services were deregulated years ago. Then moving on to the final slides, we provided the checklist here. I'll go through them very quickly, but this is just intended to be a checklist of all the pages in the catalog where a member may need to add any kind of a change in order to have this catalog customized for your situation. Part one, page one, you need to check off the applicable services that are going to be offered. On part one, page two, there's a spot where if you have a privacy policy that is separate on your website, you can tie it into this document. And the same concept on part one, page two, for an acceptable use policy and a network managed policy, which we're probably in the process of putting together right now. Also, in part one, page 21, is the dispute resolution election that I talked about earlier.
Part one, page 30, is some contact information that's needed for in this. Should a customer wish to contact you regarding privacy? On part two, page two, this document allows a table for the list of exchanges and the local services that you offer in each exchange, whether it's POTS in form of just online service or whether it's a specialized service. And then in addition, on page two, excuse me, part two, page four, a listing for what the local exchange services are provided and then what the calling areas are within those local exchange calling areas so that that information is available to the customers in a convenient form. Part two, page nine is just a carryover where we can list some custom calling capacity definitions. Part two, page 12, is where you make the election of what your telephone directory business process is. On part three, page one, an acceptable use policy link again. Part three, page two, suggests tech testing. And what we have in the boilerplate language in part three is not really intended to be a separate network management disclosure. You'll still have to do that, but it is potentially helpful to have this speed test link information there. Roger mentioned the cable TV lineup. You need a cable TV lineup in, or you can paste a text box in this table that says your cable TV lineup is available at another location or a local link or something of that nature. And then lastly, as mentioned just a second ago, part five, there's a lot of information to be filled in there with all of your services and all of your pricing. So with that, Dave, you can move ahead with the next slides.
Thanks, Bill. And again, I say thanks, Bill, in a bigger sense, because Bill really did a great job of keeping this entire group in order and being in charge of all the different drafts. I don't know how many drafts of the document we went through, and he really did a nice job managing this project, Bill. Bernie did a great job as the co-chair as well. But what's our next steps? Because we're not done yet. We were able to get a document out to everybody. Yes, we have a webcast. The webcast is going to be recorded, and if people want a copy of just slides, we can send them a PDF copy of the slides too. Call or email me or Brittany, or we'll get them to you. She'll send you a link to that stuff with a copy of these slides. So like that checklist and things like that, you won't have to write them down. We're going to reference guide to identify the IEB rule sections that are governing a lot of the different terms and conditions we have in here, because there are ruminations happening that the IEB is about ready to release yet another chapter to make that will again take a preemptive swipe at reducing the rules and regulations. And chapter 22 is really the terms and conditions set of rules that the utilities board has that govern all of local exchange service. So though we've been saying and at the IEB to deregulate local exchange service, there still are some rules in place that need to be cleaned up, that need to be modified, that need to be gotten rid of. And if you remember from our webcast that we had way back in September, we talked about some of the things that came out of the August 2017 IUB rulemaking, where I don't believe the IUB went far enough with deregulation. And so we're trying to figure out how we get a comment into record so that the IUB understands that certain of the rules that are still in there need to come out as a result of its stated objective of deregulating most of retail local exchange service. So that obviously then will have another impact on some of the terms and conditions in here. So we're going to continue to refine the document. I'm sure there's going to be some of you who suggest some best practices that maybe we'll want to consider making some changes to this model document. So it will be on our website. There's time to do it. We need it. And then all of you, of course, are going to be updating and revising this on your documents as well. So it's a living, breathing document, but I think it really reflects some great progress that our industry is making towards getting away from regulating retail service and getting closer to focusing on getting great customer assistance, as we talked about earlier, the convergence of everything towards broadband-related services that you're going to be providing. So I think this is a good time to kind of open it up for questions. I know that we'll start with the first chat question, and if anybody wants to raise hand, or I think we still have the bridge open, so you can probably talk. But the first question was from Jenny Neff, and this was back to John Patella's portion when he was talking about the different requirements for how to make your terms and conditions enforceable. They need to give real notice to consumers, and they need to accept that the terms, and it needs to be fair terms. Question is, well, how do you get acceptance from existing customers? And the thing that just popped into my mind, and I'm going to turn it to you in just a second, John, on that was, I just got something from Facebook that was a little notification that said, we have completely changed our terms and conditions, and they didn't quite say so, but what they meant is, it's bad for you, the consumer, but you're going to agree to all of these if you just continue to use Facebook after July 14th. So even if you have to opt in, I almost had to opt out to not be bound by them. So that's what your competitors are doing. So why don't we do that?
Well, again, we have a couple of issues. One is for click-through, it's easy for Facebook to use the click-through sort of process because you really do have to click through in order to use the service. And so as I've struggled a little bit with that, that would be an ideal or one practical way for a provider to do this. I'm not sure that works for us on a video product, maybe on a broadband product, but maybe not even then, and it's certainly not a local telephone product. So the specific customer, what about specific questions, what are the exceptions from existing customers? And so let me say this. First, how is the customer your customer? If they're a contract customer, the thing about a contract is it's binding not just on the customer, but it's binding on you as a company. Look, first to answer that question, if they're a contract customer, it may be that you need to grandfather their contract, and we can handle that in the service publication section of the service catalog. If they're currently a customer without a contract, are there terms and conditions, or is there a service catalog in existence today that you have the customer subject to? And so then my question is, if so, I feel that this is an update to those terms and conditions. And I would provide notice to the customer, probably 90 days, but I'm not saying there's a magic number there. Begin providing notice to the customer that effective December 1st of 2018, your terms and conditions are changing. They should go and look at those terms and conditions. And if they don't want to accept those terms and conditions, they should find an alternative service. So I think notice is the key, including that just after a certain time is going to accept those conditions. Is that a perfect solution? You know, probably short of sending something out and having every single customer sign it, they and I accept these terms and conditions, you're going to leave some questions open. But those questions have been open at least since we de-tariffed, and I don't think it's had a major impact on our customer or our relationship with our customer. Really doesn't alter the status quo maybe as much as you may have first thought if you really consider how the customer is there. So the service publication section is going to be important, I think, an important way for you to capture that. There was another question about, well, then what about when we make revisions? And that we've inserted land into the service catalog. Going forward, once you've got this service catalog in place, your customer has agreed to a process by which you can revise the service catalog, give them notice of that, and their continued use of the service will be the acceptance of those changes. So if we get under this model service catalog, I think we've got the right groundwork in place, again, for you to make fair and reasonable changes and have those be enforceable. So it's really a one-time problem. And if we think about how we got here through the tariff, the old service catalog, or maybe the terms and conditions you've already been using, let's look at those and see what they say about updates and perhaps notice this to your customers as an update and follow those current terms and conditions required. So it's going to be a little bit company by company, but those are just a couple of ideas today on how I think companies might manage that. New customers, hopefully, it's much easier. You know, you get their service application and you have them sign off on something and they understand these terms and conditions are out.
So the next question from Kevin is kind of along the same lines, John, so just to pound the issue home. They have a contract that references the service catalog, and it says which governs if there's a difference between the contract and the catalog. So if they sign a service contract, is that considered acceptance of the catalog?
I think that's right. So in this case, the company is in a separate service contract that already references the service catalog. This is going to be an update to the service catalog, so it's a good thinking of the contracts and service catalog. Remember to send customers notice that you've updated the service catalog, that they should go to the website and look at the updated service catalog and the extent it doesn't change. I talked about this. When we were talking about revisions to the service catalog and tracking those revisions, one of the important or one of the good reasons to do that is so that if you ever are caught in a situation where a customer is saying, well, hey, I know I agreed to your service catalog in 2018, but I'm not sure the 2021 changes applied to me, it'll be handy for a service provider to be able to say, well, good. The good news is this has been in there since 2018, and we don't have an argument about whether you're bound by it or not. But I think it's important to give some notice for decisions. I think it's a good practice for companies to use the catalog to kind of track the timing of those revisions as we go forward.
And the next question that came in talks about many of our companies don't offer cable TV directly, but they resell Skinner TV. So then the question is along the lines of, well, should those terms and conditions be put into the cable TV section, or should I leave it out? Or I guess the third example is, I assume Skinner already has terms and conditions that it gives for our companies to give to the customer. Who wants to handle that one?
I don't know if this quote-unquote handles it, but you know, one way you might address that, if you believe customers may be confused, I think you could change your cable television module simply to say, we do not offer our own retail video products. We do provide customers with access to Skinner. Here's a link to the Skinner terms and conditions. I'm probably speaking out of turn because I'm not sure I understand all the changes that have taken place with the Skinner business model, but I believe that's their retail service and not your retail service. And I don't think you want to have your service catalog, except maybe by reference that here's where you can go to deal with Skinner about that service. If you handle service calls, you can have another section in there saying, hey, if it's a service fall issue, you know, you can contact us. But, so the way can be straightforward with the customers about what the relationship with Skidder is and direct them where they need to go to find those terms.
Jenny, did that answer your question?
Yes, very helpful. Thank you.
Next question came from Vicki, and it's a great question. Are we still required to publish the annual IUB complaint resolution notice? Yes. Although a lot of the rules have been eliminated, I think that one is still in here because the IUB still retains limited jurisdiction over consumer complaints. So they still say the IUB is still interested in having all of the companies provide information to consumers on how to complain. I don't see any other questions. Raise your hand on the little web portal, type it in, or just blurt it out on the phone. Pretty well paid, Dodd. We didn't have a mute today. People know how to use their own mute buttons sometimes, I guess. Other questions? Any thoughts by any of our presenters on kind of following up with any of the questions, some things that maybe you just thought about that you wanted to throw in that you were talking about?
I'll bring up, it kind of falls under that bullet point. I think it was the last bullet point of the last slide, continual refinement. That's already started, I think. We've what's happened with the telephone relay service charge. We had a question from a member the other day about, well, I want to pass that to my customers, and the answer given by their consultant wasn't correct. Well, it should be in your service catalog if you're going to do that. And so we found a spot where we talked about 911, and I've talked to the member of other offices. Well, you could add the telephone relay service charge there. You could provide it somewhere else, but you're going to have to give notice to your customers and address it that way. So there's already been a question where, you know, one company decided to handle things one way, and they decided a way to do that, and then to give notice to their customers. And another company may decide, no, I've never charged that surcharge, and I'm not going to pass it through to customers now. And that's fine also. Obviously, they won't change their service catalog provision related.
Bill, Roger, final comments or thoughts?
None for me.
No, I just invite companies to take a look. See what you're going to need to do to this. Yeah. And I would hope that this is a pretty smooth transition for the large number of companies that are currently using the old ICA catalog. Obviously, there's a little work, you know, that needs to be done, but I'm hopeful that work is worth it and allows them to move ahead nicely in the future.
Well, one other thing is we went through some of the checklist items. The network management and this acceptable use policy, that may need to be coordinated with your work provider. If you're not in control of this thing, I don't know if John's got something to add to that, but I thought we probably needed to visit about that just a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I think the management policy has been very difficult for us to sort of get our arms around, in part because what happened with net neutrality and what happened with those rules and not wanting to overreact and put something into place today that was going to be stayed or overturned or reversed by the FCC. So tomorrow or 2 years later, as it turned out to be. So I think those of you who are your own ISP have probably long had your own network management policy and feel comfortable with that. If you're not your own ISP, you know, there may be some question in your mind as to whether you even need a network management policy. From the customer's perspective, I think they certainly are going to turn to you as their ISP, and the fact that you may not have a network management policy could trigger a complaint to the FCC or an inquiry that would just take time and effort and expense. And so a little bit like we talked with Skinner, or perhaps you want to have your own network management policy, but there's got to be some way for you, and this would be a good platform for you to say, here's how that network management policy requirement applies to me, and here's my network management policy or the network management policy of the ISP that provides that service to you. So, again, a little bit of a case-by-case, although we know a lot of people are going to be in the same boat with that. But it is time for us to make sure that network management policies pass muster, same as with the privacy policies. To the extent the FCC has now said to us, we're going to leave up to providers to be transparent about these things. Make sure you've got these policies. I want to follow through and make sure we have these policies and point not just to a customer, but to the FCC enforcement group that have said, now, where did you put that information?
Yeah, that makes sense. John, to the extent that folks are basically using a web label product, the network management policy can be as simple as identifying that they are using, product where network management is conducted by someone else and is distributed by someone else. And that would be what they'd have to file in for their customers. I see we have another question that's the service price list, the column, the bill code, what is that referring to? And the intent there was to allow you to, if your billing system uses code, bill code of some type, you could actually cross-reference the bill codes in billing system with what you list on the pages of the service agreement. So that was the intended function of that column. As mentioned before, it's optional.
Great questions. Everything right on target. Every question is a good question, so don't hesitate to either speak up now, type one in, or contact us, me, afterwards. Contact me after phone, and I'll do one of the really smart people that were these presenters here, and they'll tell me what the answers are, and I'll get back to you on that. Okay, there we go. Another question. Are we using that document? Can we get Word app? We will give you a Word document. The website is the Word document now. Okay. We originally had a PDF document, I think, that was sent out, but on the website, we do have the Word documents. A lot easier to modify. I know a lot of you have the ability to modify PDF. I don't, and a lot of don't. So we're easier. So we can you can go to our website under the member resources tab and find that.
And maybe this is obvious, but I guess I'll just say it procedurally. You know, I think you're able to hold lunch this and you've had a look at it and make sure it complies with your practices and procedures. Even if you've got a current catalog sitting there right now, that you feel like you may launch this and then make a bunch of changes, and I suggest that we're going to be suggesting or to turn in this service catalog and notify customers of those changes. So
maybe just as a matter of efficiency for communication with your customers, you might want to do some of that work on the front end before you launch. And that you can't just and kind of go with the flow and make changes only if banana things present themselves. But I think that's just something for you to think about internally in terms of your whole process and you know, what needs to be communicated to customers. Is this an update? Is this brand new to them? If it's brand new, you may want to launch it after you've got it satisfactory to you.
Another thing to think about in context of that, John, is when do companies normally do their rate increases, and particularly almost everybody's got an annual cable TV rate increases. So, you know, they may want to do something this fall with this document, with the understanding by customers of the rates next spring, if that's how they're handling their TV rates.
Excellent conversation. Well, thank you, Bill. Thank you, Roger, Bernie, John. As you on the phone and the webcast can tell, we did assemble the experts for this working group. They have really done all the work. This was a pleasure to work with all of you and be able to learn from all of you on all of this. So, again, thank you to our presenters. Reach out to anybody who's on the phone. You can either call our presenters or call me or email me with questions as we follow up. So, thanks for joining our webcast. And more webcasts. I forgot that. We're going to have a webcast come up. When is it? I mean, August 20th. The webcast on sexual harassment. We just scheduled it. Should be getting some information out soon to folks. August 20th at 2 p.m. And it's going to be a great webcast on something that we all need to learn from and be able to sexual harassment and workplace type stuff. So with that, we'll say thanks and take care, everybody. We'll talk to you later.